Biden, asked before he left Europe whether he could reach an understanding with Putin on cyberattacks, quipped in response, "Who knows, at this point, little progress to resolve those issues is expected. The best-case scenario for Biden," several people familiar with the planning said, "is likely to be an error-free summit and headlines back home saying he delivered a tough message, in contrast to former President Donald Trump's chummy attitude toward Putin. Netanyahu opponents strike deal to push out prime minister crisis in Syria as Russia threatens to cut off aid. Iran's largest warship sinks in blaze in Gulf of Oman. Giant sinkhole threatens house in southeastern Mexico U.S. And Denmark face allegations of spying on European allies. Israeli opposition party threatens Prime Minister Netanyahu's leadership role. Main suspect in Italian cable car tragedy held under house arrest. To hear my scream, the scream of my soul, mother of Belarus blogger makes tearful appeal. Teens win right to be considered in Australian climate change decisions. Dutch court orders Shell to cut carbon emissions by 45% by 2030. Climate campaigners celebrate groundbreaking legal victory over Shell. Italy reopens to American tourists as it tries to recover from the COVID pandemic. U.S. diplomats call on State Department to acknowledge Havana syndrome symptoms. Secretary Blinken vows to rebuild U.S. ties with Palestinians. Detained Belarus blogger's father calls for son's release. U.S. to reopen Jerusalem consulate. Blinken tells Palestinian president, "This is not a light switch moment," Secretary of State Antony Blinken said Monday. "This is about the president wanting to do two things, and he's been very clear about it. To tell President Putin directly that we seek a more predictable, stable relationship, and if we're able to do that, there are areas where it's in our mutual interest to cooperate. But if Russia continues to take reckless and aggressive actions, we'll respond forcefully. Putin and Biden are no strangers. I'm not a big fan of Putin's," Biden said in 2006, when he was in the Senate. "I think we should have a direct confrontation with Putin politically about the need for him to change his course of action." Since then, Russia has annexed Crimea, interfered in U.S. elections, hacked into U.S. companies and government computers, and been tied to numerous murders of political dissidents and journalists. Putin today, over the course of this decade, has become way more autocratic at home and way more belligerent towards the United States and the West in his foreign policy, said Michael McFaul, who was the U.S. ambassador to Russia during the Obama administration and helped prepare Biden for his last meeting with Putin. Biden, who has indicated that he would rather focus his foreign policy on China than on Russia, has said he is seeking a stable and predictable relationship with Russia. But experts say that Putin isn't looking for the same and that he has little incentive to change his behavior toward the fifth U.S. president he has dealt with in more than two decades in power. The problem, of course, is that Putin doesn't necessarily want a more stable or predictable relationship, said Alexander Vershbo, who was ambassador to Russia during the George W. Bush administration. Since his 2014 aggression against Ukraine, in particular, Putin has seen Russia as increasingly at war with the West. Biden has said he plans to address the issues of contention between the two leaders, as well as areas in which he says they can work together, such as nuclear security, climate change, and the Middle East. Sullivan said Biden will lay out his expectations for Russia's behavior and the consequences if Putin doesn't meet them, Sen. Chris Coons, D-Dell. A close ally who has worked with Biden for years on foreign policy issues, said, "He's going to look him in the eye and say, I know who you are, I know what you've done, and you're going to stop it. You cannot be weak with Putin. You have to be clear with him about what you won't tolerate and set some clear lines, but Putin also needs to realize there is a path forward for a relationship with the U.S. Netanyahu opponents strike deal to push out prime minister crisis in Syria as Russia threatens to cut off aid. Iran's largest warship sinks in blaze in Gulf of Oman. Giant sinkhole threatens house in southeastern Mexico U.S. And Denmark face allegations of spying on European allies. Israeli opposition party threatens Prime Minister Netanyahu's leadership role. Main suspect in Italian cable car tragedy held under house arrest. To hear my scream, the scream of my soul, mother of Belarus blogger makes tearful appeal. Teens win right to be considered in Australian climate change decisions. Dutch court orders Shell to cut carbon emissions by 45% by 2030. Climate campaigners celebrate groundbreaking legal victory over Shell. Italy reopens to American tourists as it tries to recover from the COVID pandemic. U.S. diplomats call on State Department to acknowledge Havana syndrome symptoms. Secretary Blinken vows to rebuild U.S. ties with Palestinians detained. Belarus blogger's father calls for son's release. U.S. to reopen Jerusalem consulate. Blinken tells Palestinian President McFaul said White House officials are keenly aware of the need to avoid the mistake made by Bush, who famously said of Putin at a news conference that he had looked the man in the eye and found him very straightforward and trustworthy. I was able to get a sense of his soul. Biden has said that when he met with Putin in Moscow in 2011, when he was vice president, he had a very different reaction. Mr. Prime Minister, I'm looking into your eyes, I told him, smiling. I don't think you have a soul, Biden told Putin, according to his autobiography. He looked at me for a second and smiled back. We understand each other, he said. And we did. That's a different kind of person, Putin said of Biden. It is my great hope that, yes, there are some advantages, some disadvantages, but there will not be any impulse-based movements on behalf of the sitting U.S. president. The most likely tangible results would be the start of a new round of arms control negotiations, called strategic stability talks, foreign policy analysts said. There could also be an announcement that the two countries are taking steps to normalize diplomatic relations, including allowing the U.S. ambassador to return to Moscow and the Russian ambassador to be sent back to Washington. Both ambassadors have been in their home countries since April, when Biden announced a new round of sanctions against Russia and the expulsion of Russian diplomats in response to election interference, cyberattacks, and other allegations. It's going to be a contentious and, in some cases, stormy affair, said Vrishpo, the former ambassador. I don't think the trajectory of the relationship is going to be fundamentally changed, but at least there will be a few areas for follow-up dialogue.